Folks, welcome to another great Light of the Southwest. I'm so excited. I'm very, very excited about today's guest. Man, where do you start? He's a veteran journalist and researcher, was with NASA for 20 years, created the first space agency news program. He's not stopping anytime soon. His experiences, some would say, would rival that of the Apostle Paul. He has an incredible website called Wally Wood News. Okay. WallywoodTechNews.com. And he continues to minister to the masses. Welcome, Wally Wood. How are you, sir?
I'm great, Brad. And how are you doing?
I'm doing fantastic, man. I was so intrigued before the interview. We got to talk about your story, Wally. It's so great that journalism is still alive in Houston, Texas, through you. And initially, the contact was talking about your family's involvement with GLC. And we'll get into that. But I really want to point people to WallywoodTechNews.com because, folks, for over four decades, he's been predicting advances in technology before they happen. Now, Wally, sir, you have five websites?
Yes.
Go ahead and name those off if you would.
Okay. WallywoodMinistries.com is number one. Number two would be TheRevelationFile.com. All right. Number three is diginomicscentral.com. Now, let me explain that. Diginomics, it's for digital economics. I came up with that word in 1998. It had never been used before. It was a brand new word in the English language, according to the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, diginomicscentral.com, about digital economics. Okay. Wow. The next one is our transparent world.com.
Yes, sir.
And then this one that you're talking about is WallywoodTechNews.com. Now, all this has to do with end time Bible prophecy. Being a research journalist, I dive deep into what's behind the scenes. Now, just to start the story, because we've got another agenda here, but when I was 8 years old, I asked the Lord to teach me about the Antichrist. You were seven when you invited Jesus into your life. I was eight, and I'm 20 years older than you. So, But I was 8 years old, and I said, Lord, teach me about the Antichrist and cause me to understand how the world would one day worship a man as a god.
Wow.
And that is where my career began, my interest in end-time Bible prophecy and world events. And that's where it started. And later on, we'll go into deeper areas of the ministry to explain to you more about what these websites are about.
Right.
But those are the five. I'm on two dozen social pages. I've written four books. And so it just goes on from there. Am I retiring? I don't think so.
Well, you know, there's no such thing in the Bible as retiring, is there, Wally?
No, there's life and death and taxes.
There you go. Taxes. Yeah. Well, you know, I'd like to go through these websites. And before we do that, you are a very qualified expert on the New World Order. Because you've had insights for a long time. You've also been able to give a perspective on the New World Order from the NASA point of view. Mm-hmm. People have no idea. And so I'm so looking forward to our interview today, Wally, as well as leaning on your wisdom and your knowledge on upcoming episodes of Word on the Street. And I'll always welcome a Light of the Southwest. And so before we get into all of that, I'm so excited about that. Your family was responsible for gifting a very strategic piece of land to GLC. And I can't thank you enough for that. And for the viewers that are seeing you for the first time of many times, would you tell us about that?
Well, it began back with my grandfather, my dad's dad. And he was a printer back in the 20s, 30s in West Texas, in Lubbock. And he put his print shop up for sale. And he asked the Lord that if the Lord would grant him a good return on that, that he would dedicate the rest of his life to putting proceeds into the spreading of the gospel. Okay, so that's where it started. So when he sold the print shop, and it was probably one of the very, very few print shops in West Texas, he got well over $1 million, and that's in 1930s type dollars.
Wow.
So he, through the process of him advancing his life, he ended up owning a dozen or more downtown city blocks of this, of Lubbock, Texas. And so when he passed away, my dad, one of two sons, inherited his portion. And so when he passed away, my mother got what dad had. Well, living in Houston, that's over 500 miles away. And there was no way that we could upkeep that property. So she decided that she wanted to get rid of it. And she prayed. And she sensed that the Lord was telling her to give the property away to some Christian broadcasting ministry. So she called Billy Graham. She called 700 Club, PTL, you name it. She called them. And along the way, she found out about this small little upstart TV network in Albuquerque, New Mexico, called Primetime TV, owned by Al Cooper and his wife, Tommy. And right. Tommy, if you're watching, we love you. And I hope that you're blessed by this testimony.
Wonderful.
So so Mom called out to Primetime and told the secretary, to Mr. Cooper, that she had this property in downtown Lubbock. Now, we did not know anything about Primetime whatsoever, okay? And the secretary says, well, it just so happens that Al is on the air right now live praying that the Lord would open a door in Lubbock, Texas.
Wow.
And Mom says, well, I'll tell you what, if he's interested, have him call me. If he's not, don't bother. So by the time Al finished saying, in Jesus' name, amen, live on the air, his secretary is waiting there on camera with a note, call the woman in Houston. She's got blocks in downtown Lubbock. So the two of them connected. And as it turned out, they get the property. Now, the reason they wanted this property in downtown Lubbock is because Lubbock sits on a plateau.
Right.
They were able to put a tower in Lubbock. They could reach five states around the Texas area. That was their right. hope and dream to expand. Okay. So Mom gives him the property. And years later, Al writes a book. I'm holding it up for you now. Oh, it's backwards on the screen. So you'll have to fix that in post-production. Oh,
I see it loud and clear. Okay. Because we had to.
Because we had to. Now you'll notice it's in quotes because he's quoting my mother. All right.
Wow.
And I'm opening it up to a page in this book. The book came out in the 90s. And he makes the comment on page 7. He says, in September of 1993, we were donated 6 city blocks, not lots, but blocks of land in Lubbock by Mrs. Wood from Houston. She had heard Paul Crouch talk about Primetime. I told Mrs. Wood we were not going to build a station in Lubbock. Her words will forever ring in my memory. Quoting, young man, let me tell you, the land is yours whether you build a TV station or not. Wow. The Holy Spirit told me to give it, and we're giving it. However, if God tells you to build in Lubbock, young man, you'd better do it. End of quote. So as a result, on May 30th, 1996, KPTB 16 Lubbock went on the air. Why? Because we had to be obedient to God. And so that was our initial investment into Primetime TV. Now, what's even more interesting to me is what remained of my grandfather's legacy. He went on to become a bank president in Lubbock and a chairman of the Chamber of Commerce. Now, a major denomination, Christian denomination, did not want a charismatic TV station in Lubbock. So they blocked all the efforts by Primetime to get a license. And then this woman comes along in Houston and says, well, the land's yours, whether you want it or not.
Wow.
And so they went on the air as Lubbock's first primary charismatic TV station. Okay. My grandfather built Jones Stadium at Texas Tech University while he served as bank president. All right. He also, in his deal with the Lord, the last thing he printed on his offset press in his print shop, my handmade lead type, hand placed lead type, the full gospel of John.
Wow.
Red letter edition on a large sheet of paper. And he happened to get it onto every Otis elevator in the nation in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. There wasn't an Otis elevator in the nation that you could walk into and see the full Gospel of John on the back wall.
Wow.
That elevator. How's that for a legacy? Isn't that amazing?
Wow. That is amazing.
And so all that goes into the history of what made up PTB in Lubbock, Texas. And there's more to the story than that. And he did leave quite a legacy for us to grow on that. And my ministry was conceived by his prediction years before I ever discovered that he had made such a prediction. And I'll share that in the next segment of the show.
Wow. What an amazing legacy. And
it's
of course,
it's not something I take for granted. Believe me, the richer your legacy, the more humble you become. If you have any personality at all.
Well, the legacy lives on.
Yes.
Wally, yes. Because I tell you, GLC is experiencing a resurgence in its original vision to carry the news of Jesus to the world through mass media. Mm-hmm. It's never been more important than it is now in this age of Marxist censorship.
Right.
And someone like yourself, a true journalist, the facts aren't emotional.
Yes.
And Lord had you getting into the facts really, really early, as early as 1972, setting you in a new way of presenting facts and predicting where technology is going and having an experience with Jesus that rivals that of the Apostle Paul. We're just so grateful for your family, and we're grateful for your contribution to GLC, and we're grateful for you. And speaking of you, let's go into your ministry. Tell the folks, maybe for the first time seeing you,
okay,
how all of this started in your life.
Well, I'm going to be very professional about this. I'm going to open up a PowerPoint presentation, which kind of summarizes the entire operation for you. I was born in 1949, and my mother had misconceived her first child before I was born and had been told by the doctors that she would never bear children again. Well, miracles as they happen, she did become pregnant the second time. And it was during the time of the second pregnancy that she fell in love with the prayer of Hannah, the mother of the prophet Samuel, and how Hannah had prayed that if the Lord would grant her a son, that she would dedicate him to a life of service before the Lord. So mom learned that prayer. And as a result, she called upon her pastor when she was 9 months pregnant with me to water baptize her for the sake of this new child, not knowing whether it was a boy or a girl. And she insisted on it, and he relented, and she was baptized for the sake of her unborn child. And so this was the prayer that she prayed in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 11. And she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of your handmaid and remember me and not forget your handmaid, but will give unto your handmaid a man child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life. End of quote. So I was born on December 14th, 1949. And I can tell you that I do not have a salvation testimony. I've never not known the Lord. I've walked with the Lord, the sinner that I am, the imperfect human being that I am, all of my life. So the only real experience I had was in 1962 when Billy Graham came to the Houston Astrodome, and we went as a family. And so I asked the Lord at the invitation, the altar call, I said, Lord, do you want me to go get baptized? And I heard the Lord say, well, I did. And I said, well, you make a good argument there, Lord. Okay. So that following weekend, I was baptized in our family Baptist church. And, but I followed the Lord's lead on that. Now, having been born in the Texas Medical Center in 1949, the first 8 years of my life in and out of Houston hospitals. I was born epileptic. I had water on the brain. Wow. Pyloric stenosis, which is a condition mostly of firstborn males, unable to eat anything in the way of solid food. And in later years, around ages 8 or 9, I had polio and tuberculosis. One of my playmates in Texas Children's Hospital was the founder of the Texas Medical Center himself, Dr. Billy Bertner. And he would come by from time to time and bounce me on his knee and take me for a walk or whatever. And so that's how my life got started, was as an epileptic. Wow. And I do have my healing testimony online. In 1956, my grandfather wrote a letter to my dad in which he addressed his oldest grandson, me, and the future he would hope that his grandson would have. Now, what you see here is a kind of a faded version, so I've cleaned it up a little bit to quote. This is my grandfather. Our Lord will certainly protect him from danger, for it is my hope and prayer that he will grow up in our Lord and become a minister of his gospel. For by the time he is of my age, the end of the world will come, and those who do not love the Lord enough to give their lives for him will be lost through the terrible action of Satan when he will take charge of the world for 3.5 years before our Lord and Savior takes it over. And that's quoting my grandfather. I did not discover this letter until the middle 80s when my father passed away, and we found this letter folded up in his Bible, and that's where he kept it all those years. By this time, I was already an ordained minister. I was already a teacher of Bible prophecy, and I was already in the news business speaking of these things. So this letter came to me as a confirmation of what my grandfather had predicted way back in 1956, 1957. In 1958, I heard my first message in church on the book of Revelation. So when we came home from church that Sunday, as was our custom as a family, Dad would sit us all down and he would go over the message that we heard in church that day. So we got a double dose of every Sunday sermon at home. And so he read out of the book of Revelation, in particular chapter 13. And this is where I first heard about the Antichrist. And I was 8 years old at the time. And this was my prayer. Lord, teach me about the Antichrist and cause me to understand how the world would one day worship a man as a god. Now, I was unaware of the scripture in Philippians 2:13 that states that God is at work within you, both to will and to do his good pleasure. So in 1972, I entered into the world of journalism. I went to work for a local Houston newspaper and a radio station. And it was at this radio station that I began my research into what we now know as the New World Order. And the newspaper had given me some information on that. This was during the Nixon-McGovern presidential campaign here in the States. But it was one evening, as I'm in this radio station, we were totally automated. So all I had to do was give weather updates and news headline updates. The rest of the time was mine. So I'm sitting in the production room with my Bible open, Daniel 2, and the information that the newspaper had given to me. And at that moment, the lights in the studio began to dim down. Now, this was unusual for me because we didn't have light dimmers in the studio. I was the only one at the station at the time. This was a midnight to 8 a.m. shift. And I listened for the music to see if we were having a power drain, but we were fine. But the lights began to dim. And then suddenly, out of the blue, this bright, brilliant spotlight from above came upon me. It was so bright, Brant, that you couldn't even see my shadows of my hands. And when that spotlight went on, I heard a voice, an audible voice that said, "My son, I've shown you in my word what's going to happen. Now I'm going to show you how. You're not to say a word without the documentation to back it up, and I'll see to it you have all the documentation you need." That was in 1972.
Wow.
From that, I began to go on to other talk shows, not by my pursuit, but by invitation, and began to speak in terms of these matters of the end of the world in light of today's headlines. And so I began my studies seriously in 1972, beginning with Daniel chapter 2, learning how that ancient prophet pointed to our day through the archives of history that would follow him. And then this resulted in 1975, the Southwest Radio Church in Oklahoma City picking up a recording that I had done on cassette tape in my bedroom entitled One World Government, Dream or Nightmare on side one, Cashless Society, A World Without Money on side two. This was in 1975. They took the tape, aired it across their global network of stations at that time, and they transcribed it. It's what you see here. So my research into the forthcoming New World Order began in Daniel chapter 2, and it resulted in my also writing my very first book that you see here to the right, Cashless Society, A World Without Money. And it was at this time, in 1987, that I found out that there was a professor in Lakewood, Colorado, named Philip Isley, who had started the World Constitution and Parliament Association. Now, as I take you quickly through these slides, I want you to remember what the Lord told me in 1972. I wasn't to say a word without the documentation, and he would see to it I had all the documentation I needed. Here I had the founder of the World Constitution and Parliament Association, and he was providing me the building blocks of this new world order, this new world, one world government. Wow. Starting with this particular document, Provisional World Parliament. There does exist to this day a world parliament that most people do not know exists. In 1965, the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions produced the world's first model of a world constitution in its complete article and section form and preamble. In 1977, the WCPA produced their first model of a constitution for the Federation of Earth. Then in 1991, they produced their latest and current model of the New World Constitution. You can go to my website at the revelationfile.com and click on One World tab. I provide you all the documents that you can download into your own computer. That latest document of the New World Constitution, 50 pages long, you can download the entire thing into your own computer. They want the people of the world to have this New World Constitution. So it's no longer a matter of conspiracy theory, folks. These are conspiracy facts. All right.
Wow.
The Lord has built my library. I'll see to it you have all the documentation you need. And I have gathered quite a library of books written by various different pundits, authors, professors, politicians, professionals, addressing the issue of a new world coming. In 2016, before an audience at my local church here in Houston, I unveiled the New Earth flag. We now have our own flag for planet Earth. NASA is considering using that same model on the patch of their Martian astronaut suits going into space. This particular unveiling of the flag is on YouTube. And at the time I was unveiling it, I was quoting from the Pledge of Allegiance to the Constitution of Earth. I hope this is astounding some of you all, because you've never heard these things before. A lot of ministries do not know these things exist. I'll see to it you have all the documentation you need. You can go to theflagofplanetearth.com if you want to find out more about this model of a new world flag. And once again, you can go to therevelationfile.com/oneworld. And there I'll take you into the World Parliament, the World Constitution, the Pledge of Allegiance, the new Constitution, everything you can ever imagine, plus more than what we've been able to mention here on that particular page on our website. Speaking before the U.S. Business Conference at the UN in 1994, David Rockefeller says, "We are on the verge of a global transformation. All we need is the right major crisis, and the nations will accept the new world order." I would think that COVID is just the right global crisis for this transformation to take place. And that's in 1994. James Paul Warburg, we will have world government, whether or not we like it. The only question is whether world government will be achieved by conquest or consent. Robert Mueller, former FBI director under Bush and Obama, we must move as quickly as possible to a one world government, a one world religion under a one world leader. That's how close we are. My favorite is Henry Spock, former Secretary General of NATO during the Eisenhower and Kennedy years, in which he said, quote, "We do not want another committee. We have too many already. What we want is a man of sufficient stature to lift us out of the economic morass into which we are sinking. Send us such a man, and whether he be God or devil, we shall receive him," end of quote. Lord, teach me about the Antichrist. And the world is systematically moving toward this one man rule. I'm reminded of what Jesus said in John 5:43, "I've come in my Father's name and you did not receive me. If another comes in his own name, him you will receive," end of quote. So my book on the cashless society went worldwide. It was translated in 15 different languages. It's only a 32-page book, not very large at all. And it was from there, 25 years later, I was asked by the publisher to come up with a sequel. And as I gave it some prayer and thought, the Lord put the word digenomics in my mind for digital economics. And I first published it in December 1998 in a newsletter that I was putting out at that time called Trans World Monitor. And that's where I established the creation of the word digenomics. Since then, the Merriam-Webster Dictionary in 2007 picked it up and called it a new word in the English language. And they published it online. You can no longer find it at the Merriam-Webster Dictionary. They removed all the new words. But at that time, it was there. A book came out by two professors in Spain in 2012 called Digenomics. And they teach Digenomics at that Spanish university. And you can find it in Spanish online anywhere that books are sold. Forbes magazine did an article entitled Digenomics back on July 24th, 2008 edition. We've done a general search of the word digenomics and found that it's gaining global traction everywhere. If you look at your screen, you'll find a number of places in which this word is being used in marketing and advertising, in conferences and workshops, things of this nature. In Seoul, South Korea, this was back in 2016, a press release was put forth by the mayor of Seoul, South Korea, on how they were going to modernize Seoul and make it the most digital city on the planet. And in this press release, they noted 6 times the word digenomics throughout that entire press release. Now again, this fella came up with that word in 1998. I did not copyright it or patent it for the purpose of making it into a public word. If I had done so, the dictionaries wouldn't pick it up. The press releases wouldn't pick it up because it would be exclusively mine. I wanted it to go worldwide, and it sure is. This press release is one of the more dynamic uses of that word, but it doesn't stop there. You go on the Seoul, South Korea website, and looking at your screen, you see the Digenomics predominates a number of their pages on that website, Digenomics. Swede Bank in Sweden has also picked it up. And they're conducting world conferences on Digenomics, workshops, seminars, things of this nature. And it predominates their major production for banks and bankers and banking systems around the world. Digenomics, new economic drivers. The world of Digenomics, the cashless world, is moving into a totally Digenomic world. Will the coronavirus force us into a cashless society? The world's first cashless society. Cryptocurrency is opening that door. COVID is part of that process. And I work in the retail business full time. And I'm amazed at how frightened people are of them handling money and you handing money to them because of fear over COVID. So cryptocurrency is growing very, very fast as a result of this pandemic. So how close are we? Well, how about the next time you buy anything? Consider the code. The number 666 appears in every standardized UPC code around the world. Every product you buy has got the 666 in it. The number 6 is represented by a thin stripe followed by a thick stripe, or two thin stripes put together, or a thin stripe. So when you look at your UPC codes on your products, you find 6 in the front, 6 in the middle, and 6 out back. The US code has 10 digits. The European code has 12 digits. This is universal. And what's amazing to me is that you cannot buy or sell without that UPC code on it. Also, when you go on the web and you type in www. Well, W is the letter Vav in the Hebrew text, and it's the 6th letter in the Hebrew text. Look at Psalm 119, verse 41. So www equals 666 every time you type in that address on your computer. Let me see if I can go back a page here. Psalm 66, verse 3. How great are your works, O Lord! Because of the greatness of your power, even the heathen feign obedience to your will. You cannot buy or sell anything without that code, Revelation 13, 17. So the declaration of our ministry, we're inspired by Billy Graham, what he said in 1962. I was 12 years old at the time, with the Bible in one hand and the newspaper in the other. You read the same words as being fulfilled very rapidly all around us every day. That's our inspiration. Our ordination comes from Isaac Newton, who said in his lifetime, in the end days, a body of men will come forth who will turn their attention to the prophecies and insist upon their literal interpretation. And I number myself among those. And of course, our motivation is from Henry Spock. Send us such a man, and whether he be God or devil, we shall receive him. So you can find us at therevelationfile.com. And at wallywoodministries.com. You can also find my weekly YouTube channel at youtube.com/revfiletv. And that's where we produce a weekly half-hour show, and it's aired 3 times a week. And we've already got over 160 programs posted on that particular website. You can also mail us at our P.O. Box 42005, Houston 77242. If you wish to give into this ministry, you can also go into our wallywoodministries.com site and make donations into our PayPal account if you so wish. The two things I'd like to have you have in your hands. One is a manuscript reproduced on the chapter of Isaiah 18. There's 7 verses in that chapter, and they address one particular nation, a mystery nation in a distant time. And the passages in that particular prophecy address this one end time nation that you need to know about. Also, my book, The Mystery, Heaven's Secret Story. One reader in California said, I wept for over an hour after reading this book. Never have I ever heard my Jesus presented this way before. Awesome. A local Bible teacher gives his testimony into what he read in this book, saying that this book is truly a revelation. A Houston pastor says, after reading this book, I now see people through the eyes of redemption and God's love for mankind. I now want to see people saved like never before. This book was a revelation to me in the writing of it, and God gave it by revelation, and I wish that every Christian would read this book, because there's a message here that we need to know going into these last days.
Wally Wood, Editor-in-Chief of the Revelation File News Service.
The Antichrist is alive. Technologically, we're there.
Fulfillment of the rest of what's been prophesied in Scripture.
Our focus is on current world trends as they relate to end-time Bible prophecy and the coming of Jesus Christ. Since 1981, the Revelation File has focused on world trends and how the world is being prepared for the second coming of Christ. And we bring these headlines alive to you. We don't do so much in the way of analysis or commentary. We just bring you the facts as you can find them yourself. And we bring them all together in the context of Bible prophecy and the scriptures having to do with the second coming of Christ.
You're going to see some elements here today that your eye has never seen before. Jesus said that the deception of those days will be so intense that if it were possible, even the very elect will be deceived. Going to be easily deceived by the strongly deceptive, what's going to keep the elect from falling into that same trap?
Our ability to manufacture fraud now exceeds our ability to detect it.
It's easier to make 100,000 believe. Just one.
For the Antichrist to rule the world, he must first be able to control the world. And the only way to control the world is technologically.
For more information, visit our website.
Wow.
TheRevelationFile.com, or you can email us at RevFileNews@Yahoo.com.
Wow.
That's it.
Wow. That's all I can say. Those of us who have watched our entire lives and we've seen very clearly what's going on, we're going to be surprised. I've never seen this before. I'm not surprised, but I've never seen this before. And Wally, are people able to access all of these sites through your WallyWoodMinistries.com site?
Yes, from Wally Wood Ministries and the Revelation File, You've got access to everything I've just mentioned here today. And the other websites kind of break it down into finer detail, because again, how is the world going to end up worshiping a man as a God?
Right.
Well, first of all, Paul tells us he's going to present himself to be God. Well, in my dictionary, a God is impenetrable, omnipresent, omniscient. Okay. Mm-hmm. This man is going to have to prove himself to qualify under the dictates of what it is to be a God. And with today's technology, he's got it.
Oh, yeah.
All it took is the technology advancements. And again, in future programs, if you wish, we can go into some of the finer details. But these phones that we carry on our belt, even when they're off, they're on.
Oh, they're still on.
If you wear a smartwatch, Time magazine, before the smartwatch ever came out, did a major expose on how it was always on. It would never be off.
Right.
We are the most transparent, trackable generation in the history of man. And that's one of the attributes of being a God. You have to be able to isolate and pick out individuals among 7.5 billion people on the planet Earth at any one time. That is now technologically possible. So that's where our transparent world, I take you into the depths of our transparency. Technology in the news, I bring in mostly videos having to do with the development of these things. Digenomics, predominantly cashless system. Right now, Google Pay, Apple Pay, and the Tap Card have removed the cashback option. So you're being indoctrinated even now to think in terms of a cashless system. Okay. So all these things have just tell the greater story at miniaturized details, mostly for believers, to give you some usage there, some evangelical uses, and for non-believers to close the gap between the noise that they're getting from the Christian world and the facts that are there in the real world, in their world, that the day had to come when there was going to be one final Caesar show up. And we're in that era now. Right now, as I've said many times, the Antichrist is in the green room. It's just a matter of moments of time to justify his appearance.
Well, brother, I tell you what, I am so happy that we are speaking with you today. And as a journalist that believes in facts over activism is what we've been seeing, right, it all seems to add up. But these websites are priceless sources, folks, of true news, factual news, real news. Some people have short memories. They believe that a conservative network is conservative when it's just a different head of the same snake.
The one thing that I have avoided in all the years I've been doing this, you don't pay to get my opinion. I don't give commentary or opinion. Because as I've said, Jesus didn't die on the cross that I might have the right to have an opinion about anything. Okay? And dealing in a day where, as I said in the video, the deception that was coming, How would the saints avoid that trap? Know the facts. Jesus said in Matthew 24 more than once, stay on the alert. Be on the alert. Don't be caught off guard. I've said this also, the more you know, the less you fear.
Right.
And I'm in the business of feeding knowledge. As God has brought me the evidence, I'm feeding it back to listeners who want to know, so that the more you know, the less you fear. This pandemic, this COVID thing, is part of the manufactured fraud that you heard referred to in that piece. And I don't have to name names. I'm not in the business of naming names and pointing fingers. I just bring you the straight facts as they are and let you come to your own conclusion.
Well, I'm excited to find a new news source.
And yeah,
you know, Wally, this is the first of many times, and I don't know how much time we've got, But folks, you are alive to see things unfold that you've always read about. And I don't know about you, Wally. I never subscribed to the attitude of, oh, I'm not going to worry about it. I'm not going to do anything. Jesus is going to take me out
right
before it gets bad. I personally have never subscribed to that in my attitude. I've always wanted to be in it to win it,
yes,
to the life and to the death. But you know what? We ought to be sold out to Jesus and excited that his word is true.
Yeah.
And the news only verifies that. And we've not been given a spirit of fear, have we, Wally?
No. There had to come a point in the course of history when the last generation would show up. Jesus said in Matthew 24 that the generation that saw these things would not cease to exist, would not pass away until everything had been fulfilled, which included his return. Ours is the generation that will see with its eye the splitting of that eastern sky. And that's the excitement, because what did God see in me? What did God see in you? What did God see in us that caused him to say, I will reserve their life to the very end, because they will be the most dynamic of all the generations of believers to ever go before. As we read in Daniel 11, in the height of the most fearful time in the history of man, the Antichrist will wear down the saints. But as he's doing so, those who know their God will rise up and do great exploits. What great exploits? It begins where Jesus left off. He did great exploits.
Right.
We will pick up where he left off in doing even greater exploits, as he pointed out we would in those last days. So the best and the worst is yet to come. And we are the people who know Christ, who have been set aside to become a dynamic generation of people that will usher in his return. Praise the Lord.
Wally, where you been the last 50 years, brother? You've been active. You've been proactive. You have fought the good fight. You continue to. But I'm so excited to meet you and for our viewers to get acquainted with you and reacquainted with you. We have a whole new demographic that's beginning to watch, in addition to our pillars,
yeah,
that support the work of putting out the truth, of sharing, just like the original mission states, to share the message of Jesus with the world through mass media. And, you know, as we do this, we fight the prince of the air.
Yeah.
That's why,
yeah,
it's important to get behind people like Wally, and to go to WallyWoodMinistries.com,
yes,
and that portal that will take you to these other news sources. I'm surprised that you're not being censored, Wally, but I'm happy that you are protected from that right now. I'm sure there's plenty of people who would like to silence you. But you know, I have a feeling they're not going to succeed.
Well, again, when you abandon the practice of criticism,
right,
and name calling, okay? And when the Lord called me into this 1972, as I made plain a while ago, you're not to say a word without the documentation to back it up. So that limits even my desire to give commentary and opinion. I'm to only speak what's there. And I've saved more people at a jack-in-the-box than I ever have behind the pulpit of a church. I've taught in Bible studies where I allowed the participants to have a can of beer to my one can of Coca-Cola. And we have accomplished a great deal when it comes to feeding the deep hunger of people who do not know and don't even know that they want to know until they start to hear it. And then there's something that kicks inside. I think it's the God factor, that God connection.
Right.
So listen to this.
Wow.
Many stories to tell, brother. Many stories.
You know, Wally, your experiences, your commissioning, your anointing, your knowledge, people with not even a fraction of that can be so boisterous and so loud and accomplish so little and do so much damage. But like you just said, just like the prince of the universe sitting down and breaking bread with the salt of the earth, sharing infinite knowledge and wisdom from above. That's the kind of man that the world needs. And that's the kind of man that you are. You know, folks, it's never been a more important time to refuse to conform to the pattern of this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so get behind Wally Wood and get behind GLC as we take not just our territory back, but all of the enemy's territory. You know, we fight the prince of the air when we're doing what we're doing right now. Mm-hmm. Wally is on the front line fighting the prince of the air. And we're taking all of the territory, aren't we, sir?
Yes, sir.
And giving that to the kingdoms, because we will hear one day that the kingdoms of this earth are now the kingdoms of our God. And I'm so grateful to get to meet someone like you, Wally. And I can't wait for the next time.
Thank you, Brant. May I add one final closing thing on my end?
Please.
To those who are uncomfortable with those of us who are looking for the Antichrist, I would remind you that the Antichrist is pre-Christ.
Wow.
Once he was conceived, Paul tells us that he that lets will let until he be taken out of the way, speaking of that which was blocking the appearance of the Antichrist. And that goes into a whole new different topic, okay? But here's my weight on the matter. Once that man was conceived, because God always knew who his parents would be from the foundation of the world, God wasn't caught by surprise when he was conceived that day. Once he was conceived, history was set, prophecy was set in motion, and he is pre-Christ. The next major thing is the appearance of Jesus in the sky. There is a rapture. The timing is controversial, but there is a rapture because Jesus promised it. But even more than that, he says, I'm coming back to set up my own rule on the earth. So that's why we look at these headlines microscopically.
Wow.
Because these are the signs of the times. Amen.
A man of the word and a man of the facts.
Amen.
The facts are not emotional.
Amen.
And so thank you again. Such an honor to meet you, my new friend. And I can't wait until the next time. So thank you for being with us, Wally Wood.
Thank you, Brant. And we're looking forward to all future episodes.
Yes, sir. And thank you, folks, for watching Light of the Southwest. We'll see you next time.